if by some terrible, terrible concatenation of circumstances, both my co-pilot and I on this flight were suddenly taken ill, how would you land this plane?
Can't they just land themselves on an instrument's landing?
Can't you?
I'd stop reading the Kindle on the steering wheel.
That would be a wise start, yes.
Don't you radio... There's the co-pilot slumped, normally.
Yes.
In these situations.
Yeah, someone talks you in.
And somebody talks you in?
That's what happens in the movies, definitely, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes, like Robert Duvall, probably, would be good. Yes. That's who I'd ring.
Well, Lloyd Bridges, in the case of Airplane, the
Perfect
movie.
Perfect choice.
Yeah.
Yes. Presumably there are legal problems with someone talking you down, though, because you could then subsequently sue if it was interpreted by your relatives that you were given bad advice. So probably these days the air traffic controller would refuse to give advice and say, I'm sorry, right. we're not covered for my saying.
You'd have to sign a waiver and sort of text it to them, and then insurance would cover you to be talked
it down. It is a minefield. Extraordinarily and happily, it has never occurred in commercial airline travel history that someone has been, as it were, oh, gosh, can anyone fly this plane because right. the pilot and co-pilot are ill or dead. It's never actually happened, but it would be fraught with difficulty. They have tried various simulations. For example, those with American civil private pilot licenses in America who can fly light planes were invited onto simulators of big jets. Yeah. And one of them couldn't even operate the seat that moved him towards the control. Another one turned the radio off. Another one turned off the autopilot and instantly crashed the plane. So the fact is, it's incredibly difficult.
Stephen, am I allowed to say that, in your uniform, how incredibly unlike a pilot you look?
So what do I look like instead? Be brutal, be frank.
I think you'd be the chap who calls himself the bursar. He comes round, he's got a big leather wallet and takes money for duty-free.
Yeah, calls himself the bursar.
Yes.
He calls himself the bursar?
Yes, I think he does, yeah.
Or the bursar.
The bursar.
The bursar is like the one that does the money for a...
Public school.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah.
Well, what kind of planes are you flying on? Yeah. Yes, the bursar will be collecting money for the end of term jamboree.
Here on a Charterhouse Air.
Yeah.
The bursar with the trolley and then with the drinks, the groundsman.
Anyway, the fact is it's fraught with difficulty. The first problem you would have is simply getting into the cockpit, because since 9/11, of course, cockpits are locked. And if the pilot and the co-pilot were truly too ill to be able to fly, they may well be too ill even to let you in to the cockpit. But
do they have a secret knock?
when
they go and give them their lunch, though, surely they have to get in.
Yes.
So they must have a coded knock or something. Like, it's me. I've got your lunch. Something like that. And they go, oh, must be the lunch.
It must be, yeah. It must be JJ with the lunch. The lunch is. Now, why do I say lunch is?
Because there's more than one.
But why is there more? You are accruing points at a fantastic rate.
God, I tell you what.
Yes, there are more than one. But why would there be more than one lunch?
They have to eat different meals.
Yes, the pilot and the co-pilot must eat different meals.
Oh, in case one of them gets botulism.
Exactly, so that if one is by accident poisoned or whatever. And in the case of extra long-haul flights, there are three pilots, not two.
So you can't get into the cockpit. It's very, very dangerous. Never been done.
Yeah,
so...
and if it was on autopilot, you'd be able, obviously, to fly level and it would continue. But once you got into the landing situation, yes, the kind of film scenario would take over, whereby you would be told how to operate the flaps and at what speed. But there are so many variables in terms of glide path and vertical and horizontal axes and so on. This really is extraordinarily difficult. There is an auto land system.
There's no way of flying it remotely, then, from the ground. Like with just somebody with a Wii or something, you know. I don't know.
Maybe one day.
Someone comes in the room.
What? Why? Oh.
It's a horrifying thought. But fortunately, as I say, it never has yet happened in major commercial air travel.
What conclusion did the great biologist Stephen Jay Gould draw from a lifetime study of fish?
Oh.
Yeah.
They haven't got any legs.
Is that his lifetime study?
Yeah. Well, no. It wasn't his lifetime study of a fish.
Yeah. After a while, they smell.
Yeah. He's a bit thick and he just stared at him and they haven't got any legs.
Starfish, and... starfish don't have brains. It's the kind of Louis Walsh of the aquatic world. They really don't have brains, they're starfish.
And they're not really fish, are they, starfish, to be honest?
Well, there were fishes in there, which kind of qualifies them, I think.
Well, is a starfish a fish? Is a jellyfish a fish? Well, is a cuttlefish a fish?
Yes,
is a
sea
horse a horse?
But the starfish...
A is a monster.
There's a division, isn't there, in the world, whether it should be down to sort of experts in biology, whether things are fish, or whether it should be down to menus.
Yes.
Certainly, for example, a crayfish comes under fish in a menu.
He looks like he's reading the sell-by date on that.
He does, doesn't he? Stephen Jay Gould was very great. He's dead now. He's very great. He won a Nobel Prize. He was a paleontologist and an extraordinary biologist. And he came to a conclusion, which is...
They can feel no love.
No, that they... that there is no such thing as a fish. A fish has no biological meaning. There is just...
Oh, that's so... I'm absolutely
that's
right. Go with menus.
On a menu, it does. But in a menu, a fish is not the same as shellfish or seafood, is it?
It often comes in the same bit and separate from pudding.
Things that live in the sea.
How can something not be something? Something can't be not something, can it? But if you've created a something, then something has to be that something, otherwise you haven't created a something. So it has to be a fish. If there is the idea of a fish in the first place.
I swear there's a philosophy on the same somewhere.
Slow down, Plato.
There's some sort of ontological argument going there. And, of course, to us, that we use the word fish. But biologically speaking, a salmon is more related to, say, a camel than it is to a hagfish. Like, there are lots of things that fly, like a bumblebee flies, a vulture flies, and there are flying lizards. They're not all birds.
No.
But we call things that swim in the sea fish, and actually, biologically, evolutionarily, they have absolutely nothing to do with each other at all. So, after a lifetime study of fish, biologist Stephen Jay Gould concluded that there's no such thing as a fish. Have you read 1984? Hands up if you read 1984. Wow, that's pretty good. How many... Yeah. The fact is, research on several occasions show that at least a quarter of the people who claim to have read 1984 are lying. So I'm afraid we have to take points away from you. Yeah. Can you put your hand up if you said you'd read it, but actually secretly you haven't?
Oh, come on.
Come on.
You look very secretive.
Yes. The honest man at the back has earned some more the audience. I have to confess here, I studied English at university. I haven't read it.
I should hope not. What kind of English degree would it include something written as late as 1940?
Well, that's true. Yes, we read things written in 1370. But I kind of felt I didn't need to, which is an appalling thing to say.
Oh, it's terribly good, Stephen.
Well, I kind of... I know
the TV shows named after it.
Two, at least. Room 101 and Big Brother.
Oh, that's
ruined my... Oh, sorry! I know how it opens. It opens with the clock striking 13. I know the character's
really
called
good,
Winston.
And they made a film of it with John Hurt.
Yeah.
It's really cool. It's hard to bother, isn't it, when there's a great film of a book? I was the same with A Muppet Christmas Carol. I feel it's been done. I know what the turkey does in the story.
It is a masterpiece of a film, it has to be said.
I lie a lot to impress people. And I'll be honest now, I've never read The Hungry Caterpillar. So close to the end, and I get too emotional. I'm like, he's gonna die. He's overfed himself. I can't do it, and I stop. So I just pretend that I've read it.
No, he becomes a butterfly.
Is he Kaiser?
Spoiler!
So sorry, that was wrong of me. Oh. When I knew someone who gave away the end of Psycho. It's nearly as serious as that.
Oh my God.
There are some books that you don't need to bother reading, like good books that you don't need to bother reading. Mm-hmm. Like, it's controversial to say it, but I didn't think Harry Potter is worth reading. It is so expertly narrated on the audiobooks.
You're so right.
It is! It is!
It,
I mean... No, but I do, after I listen to the Harry Potter books, with you narrating them, everything in my life is narrated by Stephen Fry. All my thoughts, my internal monologue, is now Stephen Fry's voice. Even the dirty thoughts are Stephen's voice. I had a sexual thought the other day, but I put my hand in the air, I had a sexual thought about Camilla Parker Bowles. It didn't seem weird, because Stephen was saying it to me.
An Englishman and a Frenchman were drilling a tunnel under the channel. Who made sure they met in the middle?
They all really dressed.
The Frenchman is called Philippe Creuset, and the Englishman is called Graham Fagg. They did meet in the middle. I mean, they were like just like 300 odd millimeters out. I mean, it was extraordinary how accurate it was. But what would they use to know exactly?
Sonar,
where they,
I would imagine.
Shouting? Sonar, not shouting. No. Just. We are healed! Oh, we've gone past him!
That's the way.
Coming back.
So then they would just say, no, 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 it's two tunnels. One is yeah, the next tunnel.
We'll keep going, we'll keep going.
Have you read Birdsong by Sebastian?
Indeed,
Falls?
Yes.
It's all about tunnelling.
The saps. The yeah.
It's a brilliant book.
It is
but they would tunnel underneath the enemy trenches, plant explosives, and then. But of course, the other side were doing the same thing. So they would be. It's a brilliant novel. Yeah. They're in the tunnel, and everyone has to be completely quiet, and they can hear the Germans tunneling.
Yeah.
And they think, are they going to let their bomb off? Are we going to let our bomb off? I can't see how quiet it's got. That's how good the book is.
Yeah.
Right. I'm not going to tell you what happens.
Yeah.
But it's really good.
It is.
Be a Scot, be an engineer.
It wasn't a Scot, I'm
come
afraid.
Come on.
You'd think
been.
It would be.
Oh, well, is that Superman up the top there?
It is Superman.
Well spotted.
Hey, what's going on? Yeah.
They were told to wear high visibility clothing, and he did.
Yeah. Well, no, he came straight from a party the night before.
I think he did. Obviously, it was some celebration there.
That machine that they used, they had it at the side of the motorway for ages after they'd finished the tunnel. It had a large sign on the side of it, just said, "One careful owner."
The French rather sweetly gave them names: Brigitte, Europa, Catherine, Virginie, Pascaline and Séverine, and they, after the tunnel, they dismantled them and rebuilt them and, you know, kept them. And the British didn't give them names, rather dully, and they made the machines burrow themselves into the ground where they just left them.
Oh, oh. That says it all, doesn't it?
Oh.
I'm ashamed. Oh. I'm faintly ashamed. I'm
so who did get them to meet in the middle?
A German invented a machine to do it. And the machine is called a gyrotheodolite, because the problem is you can't know where you are underground because you can't use a compass because of the magnetic ore in...
Or GPS.
Or GPS, because you haven't got line of sight, obviously, with the...
Turn left.
Yeah. So it uses, being a gyrotheodolite...
Do a U-turn when possible.
When possible.
Yes.
Please do a U-turn.
You are under the sea.
Yeah. But no, it was. What would a gyrotheodolite use to find out where you are or where north is? So gyro means?
Revolving.
Revolving. It's the rotation of the Earth.
Ah.
Feels that. So it can work out where north is.
Oh,
so
why don't you just ask Superman?
Yeah, you just ask Superman, who has a little place in the North
Superman's
Pole.
Superman's got a hard hat. Come on, you're the Man of Steel. Not too careful.
Yeah. So it was a German invention. His name is Max Schuller.
So they had one at each. What the French had one of these machines, and the British had one of these.
They didn't meet halfway, however. Who had got furthest? The French or the English?
Oh, the English, surely.
No, we got further.
It was the French, because the English were wandering about disposing of the earth out the bottom of their trousers, making sure nobody could see. Just past the guy vaulting the horse. We'll be fine. Come on.
We got further.
Yes, but not because the French were lazy and work shy.
Well, they were talking to their machines, weren't they? My beautiful machine.
They had geological difficulties their end.
Oh, we are experiencing geological difficulties at the moment, mon petit cher, but soon it will all be good. No, they're giving the names.
Lazy English does it work. Yeah. remind me, Stephen, of the German who made, what was it, a gyroscopic theodolite?
Yes.
Because I've got to say, a brilliant invention, but not a huge market.
No, you're right. That's unfortunately true. There are just not enough tunnels being built there.
They have sword too.
Yeah.
It's all going very well. Yes. We were hoping for sales of one, but they're selling two.
There was a man called Colonel Barog, who could have used it in India when they were doing a tunnel for the railway there, and... They missed, and he went home and shot himself. It was so ashamed.
Did he hit?
Yeah. What is the roundest thing in the universe?
Yep. No, just saying.
Oh, no! Oh, not at all.
You should see it. I know. The roundest thing in the universe?
Yeah.
Ball bearings.
Ball bearings are quite round, but they're
swallowed a ball bearing.
The roundest. give it smoothest, most.
Well, the most purely round. In other words, because if you, well,
the Earth is thingy, is it squashed? It's not round. Not
right. No, that's right. It's an oblate spheroid.
Oh, Nelly Furtado! Yeah.
He's got a word for everything.
Is it a liquid drop, a water drop?
They can get jolly round. They can be very round. Very nice. We're actually further out of space than Earth, beyond Earth. It's a cosmic phenomenon.
Is it a black hole?
It's that kind of a deal.
Oh, it's those space helmets, those big round helmets. The things on the top. Is it the thing called the genius point? Is it the point to which everything goes to, ultimately?
Not that. It's when a supernova has a gravitational collapse, it turns into something called a neutron star.
No. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
That's... Oh, the neutron star.
Yeah. They're really round.
That's not round!
No, that's not. That's a supernova, I think. That's a supernova. Going supernova.
Then show us the round thing!
He's very upset, aren't you?
Yes!
It only has a diameter of about 15 miles or so, and there isn't one near enough for you to be able to see it with the naked eye.
Have you ever noticed how we always have to take Stephen's word for it?
But what's interesting is that if I had a thimbleful of a neutron star, it would weigh more than a mountain.
Yeah, but you don't.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll tell you what, imagine how confused the old woman darning your socks would be if you had a thimbleful of it. She was just trying to fix a hole and there's all space and time coming out of a thimble. That's no way to treat the elderly.
You're right.
So you put a thimble down and no one could pick it up.
No one, no one at all.
And when you've got a good cleaning lady, you want to hang on to them. You don't want to mess it around. I'm leaving, Mr. D. Why? Well, because of all this space business with your thimbles. I don't like it.
It might have double the mass of the sun, but it's only 15 miles across, roughly. And the highest mountain on it is where it's 5 millimetres. So it is superbly round.
Because
as opposed to the Earth, which, although the Earth is jolly round, apart from the flat bits at the top, the point about the Earth is it's actually jolly smooth compared to, say, a billiard ball.
Smoother than a ping-pong ball, isn't it?
Yes, now, why is that a snooker ball...
I'm sorry, I did not know there would be a follow-up question.
Yeah.
why is the Earth...
If you were to scale up a snooker ball to the size of the Earth, the mountains and trenches would be hugely greater than our highest mountains or deepest trenches, i.e. the little pits that you can see when you examine a snooker ball closely, if scaled up to the size of the Earth, would be gigantic. So the Earth, in that sense, is smoother than a billiard ball.